Okay, as planned, so today we will have a very special guest lecture, because I'm sure that the knowledge we will have today, we will be shared today, is very useful for all of us. And also, this is beyond of our topic in SPE, in power plant engineering. So please pay attention, and because I'm sure what the guest lecturer will explain today is very, very good, and also improve your knowledge, okay? Before we will start, I think I will have a bit introduction to our guest lecture. I know some of you maybe still remember this honorable guest lecture. Okay, wait, I will open his CV first. Okay, so our guest lecture today will discuss about economic engineering. So he will explain about the investment of the of a power plant, especially in wind turbine power plant. Okay, and then this time we will have Andreas Lucian. So diplom engineering Andreas Lucian. He is from Germany, and then he get his bachelor degree from Aachen University. Am I pronunciation is correct, Andreas?
Aachen. Yeah, that's perfect.
Okay,
perfect.
Aachen University, so he got 2 degrees from mechanical engineering and also industrial economics. Okay, and then as usual, yeah, as always at the end, so we will have his explanation. His lecture is about 1 or 2 hours, and then after that we will have question and answer session. And if you have questions during the lecture, you can write in the chat, or you can wait until the explanation finish and the lecture finish. It's fine, it's up to you. Either one, then you can write it in the chat, or you can directly ask to Andreas. Okay, without further ado, I think I will give time and also the Zoom space to Andreas. Please, Andreas, welcome.
Arini, thank you very much. Hello, everyone. I hope you can understand me. You can hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Okay, perfect. Just a second. Can you see the screen now? Can you see
yes,
the presentation?
Yes.
Okay, but I think, okay, I hope you can properly see the presentation, at least a little bit more properly than I do. Okay, hello everyone. I'm happy to see that you're all interested in this topic which I brought to you today. I think the investment in renewable energies is a very important topic, at least for me, because I think we all see the climate is changing. Yeah, here in Europe, so I'm from Germany, we see a dramatic increase of dry periods. The last 3 years have been really, really dry. And so that farmers are facing big problems in getting enough water on their fields. We have also sometimes periods of dramatic floodings in the contrast. So in total, at least here in Europe, and I think it's similar for you in Indonesia, the problems of the climate change become more and more. And from my perspective, renewable energies are one of the key levers that can help us preventing climate change and especially the impact of the climate change. And what I want to bring to you today is how to do an investment into climate, into renewable energies. And this means to do good things and also to make money with it. So investment into a good thing does not always mean that you have to only pay, but you can even earn money with this. And this is what I want to show you in the next, let's say, 1 hour. So let's directly start into it. The agenda for today is, first of all, I want to show you a little bit the technological background and how you select a proper location for your wind power plant. And in the second part, we will do the economic evaluation, and I will show you how you properly select a good investment and how to see if this investment is really profitable or not. So, starting with the first part, the technological aspects. And I know many of you are engineers, so I think many of you know how a turbine works, but for all of you who are not so familiar with it, first of all, I want to start and give you some basic knowledge about wind turbines. What you see here is a picture of a typical wind turbine. We have a rotor with three blades. These are the blades that capture the wind. Then we have here on top the nacelle. The nacelle is where the generator is. The generator transforms the energy from the air into electricity. Yeah, here in this nacelle is also some instrumentation and control equipment, and sometimes even a gearbox. Yeah, a gearbox is not always necessary. There are some types without a gearbox, but in case you need one, then it will be located here on top. Then below the turbine and the nacelle, we have the tower. And the tower is what connects the nacelle with the foundation here on the bottom. And the foundation, I think, is known to all of you who has ever built a house. Yeah, this is where everything is based on. And also on the ground level, you can hardly see it. You have the connection to the grid. And from the grid, from this connection, there are usually power lines in the ground that go then to the transmission lines. So this is how you bring the power, the electric power from the power turbine into the national grid and to all the consumers. Let's see how the power transformation in a power turbine or in a wind turbine works. Usually, and this is hopefully how it is before the wind turbine, you have some wind blowing. Yeah, the stronger the better, I would say. Behind the turbine, the wind is much less. Yeah, so I here showed it by the V1 and V2. The V is the variable standing for wind speed. And the power of the wind, most engineers, I think, know this equation. The P is the power, is 1/2 of the material stream multiplied by the square of the wind speed. Yeah, and then you can compare the power before the turbine with the power behind the turbine. And the difference in these two powers is then the power that is harvested by your wind turbine. And this is what you see down here. So the next step, and I know this is again an equation, and I don't want to bother you too much with any equations. And this is not the last equation, but what you should take with you is actually not really the equation, but the meaning of the equation. Yeah. And on top, you see here that again, the equation which you have seen on the slide before, and then you can do some transformation of this equation, and then you get to the equation down below. And the transformation, yeah, which is shown here by these three dots, this is not the important thing. Yeah, this is something I think Irini can explain you much better than I can. But what you should take out of this session is the meaning. Yeah, and the meaning is that you have two variables in this equation that are properties of your wind turbine, and you have two variables that are properties of your location, yeah, and the general environment. And what I want to show you in the next slide are why these variables are important for your investment. So let's start with the first variable. This is the CP. Yeah, the CP is the power coefficient of your wind turbine. And power coefficient is what you see here on the next slide. The power coefficient is shown by the red line, and the power output is shown by the gray line. So, and what you want to have is the high power output. Yeah, why you want to have it, I think to many of you is already clear, but to all of you who are not so familiar with it, I will show later on. But you want to have a high power output. Yeah, but for each wind turbine, it's the power output is limited. Yeah, this is because all your equipment, the generator, the gearbox, and so on, the rotors, they are designed for a maximum power output. So, and therefore, if you exceed this maximum power, then you will get into problems and you will damage your generator and your gearbox and so on. And this is why all wind turbines have this upper limit for the power output. And you can control your wind turbine with this power coefficient. Yeah, the power coefficient is actually showing how much energy you harvest out of the wind into your power turbine and how much electricity you generate. And as you can see on the red line, yeah, so the more wind speed, and this is shown here on the horizontal line, the higher the wind speed, the higher in the first part the power gets. But once you get and you reach this upper limit, then the coefficient, the power coefficient goes down, yeah? And this means, for instance, that you take the blades out of the wind, yeah? So that you take less energy out of the wind into your turbine and generate less electricity, and or not really less, but a lower share, yeah, of electricity. And this is why this power coefficient is very important, and this is the variable that you use to control the amount of energy that you take out of your wind. So, and the next variable, this is the D square. The D square is, or the D actually is the diameter of your rotor. Yeah. So, and as you can see, the diameter goes into this power equation even by its square. So that means that the diameter of your rotor is really important when it comes to the power output. Yeah, the higher the diameter, the higher the power output will be if all other variables stay the same. And therefore, this turbine with the big diameter D1 can take more power out of the wind than this smaller turbine with only the D2 diameter. And therefore, often you see turbines with very, very long blades. And especially when you see offshore wind turbines, then the diameter are sometimes extremely long and extremely big. And this is because of this connection between the power and the diameter. The next variable is now, and now we are looking at the location, the properties of the location is raw, meaning the density of air. Yeah. And as most of you know, when you're standing on foot or on the bottom of a mountain, the density of air is higher than when you're standing on top of a mountain. Yeah. But actually, the difference of density is not that high. So therefore, you can say, okay, the density of air, it plays a role, but it's not the major role. Yeah. And as many of you, when you look around and drive into the countryside, you see many, many turbines standing on top of the mountain. And if you only have a look on this raw, so the density of air, you may wonder and think, why are all these turbines standing on top of the mountain? And this is because of the next variable. This is the wind speed. Yeah. Usually, the wind speed on top of the mountain is much higher than at the bottom of the mountain. And this is because the wind can freely blow here on top. And on the bottom, you have always some barriers and obstacles that prevent the wind from blowing freely. And therefore, many, many turbines stand on top of the mountain. And another influence is also that you have the wind speed to the power of three. Yeah. So this is why the wind speed is the major role when it comes to the power output of your wind turbine. Yeah. You have a good location when you have a stable and strong wind. Yeah. This is what you want to have. So, and now I brought to you some other important factors. And here I have shown three divided into this table. And first, let's have a look on the upper left part and this upper left influence. And this means the position of the wind turbine. If you have two turbines standing behind each other, this is really, really bad because the first turbine will shadow the second one, yeah, the one standing behind the first. And therefore, the second one will not see the strong wind that the first one does see. And therefore, you want to position your turbines next to each other, but not behind each other. Yeah, because when you have them next to each other, both turbines can see the high wind speed and not only one of them. The next aspect is the orientation of the wind turbine towards the wind. Yeah, it's quite usual. I think everyone knows that if the wind is acting on the turbine from the side, then you will harvest, almost no wind or no energy out of the wind. Yeah. So you always want to have the wind turbine facing the wind directly. So I think this is quite clear. And this is not really a miracle. Then let's get to the third aspect, meaning the turbulences here on the bottom left side. When you have wind with high turbulences, yeah, and turbulence, for all who are not so familiar with it, means that the wind is not blowing straight, but you have like swirls and so on in your wind. So the wind is in like a wave form or something. So this is shown here with this circle, let's say. So if you have high turbulences in your wind, this is not so good when you want to harvest the energy out, yeah, because the blades can better work with straight wind. Wind blowing straightly on your turbine. And now the final influencer is the distribution of the wind. And what you do not want to have is a wind that is really not evenly distributed. Yeah, as you see here on the left side, you have a very strong wind on the top, but a low wind at the bottom. And actually, when you want to harvest your wind, then you want to have an even distribution. And this means, especially strong wind on the top and on bottom of your wind turbine. So these were, let's say, the mainly technical aspects when you choose your location. You want to have strong wind, you want to have a big rotor, you want to have a high density, and this is very important from the technological side when you choose your location. To get all this, we want to have a look at these additional aspects. You see sometimes offshore wind parks, the reason, or at least one of the reasons why why people build offshore wind parks is because above the sea we have a strong wind blowing because there are no obstacles in the sea, and the wind is very stable. There are less turbulences because there are no obstacles. And this is therefore a very good location when you want to harvest the energy out of your wind. There are also only a few obstacles when you have a look on a plain field. Here, as you can see at the horizon, the wind can just blow freely over the field. Different is already when you think of forests and small villages. Here you have, with all the trees and so on, you have obstacles for the wind that prevent blowing the wind freely. And these trees and also small houses, they will start building or generating turbulences in your wind, and they will prevent having an even distribution. And therefore, even large cities with skyscrapers are even worse, because with all the skyscrapers and high buildings and so on, you have many, many obstacles in the that prevent the wind from blowing freely. And therefore, as you can see here, the open sea is the best location. And if you're in a vicinity of a big city, then this is, let's say, one of the worst locations you can think of. So these were mainly the technological aspects when you think of wind turbines. But what is really, really important, at least when I tell you about Europe and especially in Germany, are also the other aspects, this is what I have listed here, and this is what you also have to think of. It's not only the technology. You can have a good technology, and the technology can even be beneficial for everyone, at least from the financial side. But if you have people protesting against your wind turbine, because they do not want a wind turbine in their vicinity, then you get into real big trouble. Because in Germany, many, many wind parks cannot be built because people go to court because they do not want to live next to a wind park. And why do they go to court? They go to court because they don't want to have noises from the wind park. They sometimes are afraid that protected species get killed by the turbine, especially birds who may fly into the rotor of your wind turbine. They may get killed. And also you have the one effect that is called shadowing effect. So when the wind turbine is turning and the rotor is turning, and the sun is also shining, you have the shadow of the blade running over your field and over the open area below the turbine. Yeah, and if you're living next to the turbine, then it happened in the past that people were sitting in their house and this shadow was always running over their house. Yeah, because the rotor is turning and therefore the shadow is running also. And this is what sometimes people made crazy. And therefore, people do not want to live close to a wind turbine. And there's also another aspect that is really can be of a danger in rare cases and really, really rare cases, especially today. Sometimes one blade of your rotor of the wind turbine can break. Yeah. And due to the centrifugal force, this blade can fly a very long distance. Yeah. Therefore, in Germany, we have the rule that is called 10H rule. And 10H means that the distance between your wind turbine and any residential area needs to be 10 times the height of your wind turbine, yeah, in order to prevent any damage and any noise infection or any shadow effect from anyone living in the vicinity of a wind turbine. So, and therefore, this is the reason why you really have to make sure that the population living in that area accept your wind turbine and the wind park project. What is also important is that you keep away from protective infrastructures. I told you about the blade flying long distances. Yeah. And of course, if in, and only if a blade breaks, then it's, it cannot only fly into a residential house, but it can also fly, let's say, in power transmission lines, in gas pipelines, or into an important road. So therefore, you also want to keep a certain distance to that. I told you already about a protected species. This is another aspect. Yeah, you want to make sure that protected species do not get hurt by your wind turbine, and therefore in natural reserves it's at least here in Europe not allowed to build your wind turbine, and if there are protected species in that area, you need to do some compensation measures. Yeah, so you need to bring these protected species to other areas where they can live instead. What you also want to make sure is that you have a certain grid connection. Yeah, you generate electricity with your power plant or with your windmill, and this needs to get somehow into the national grid. Yeah, so you want to have some a certain grid connection, and of course you want to have a road access. At least when you construct and build your wind turbine, yeah, you need to transport all the parts and the workforce and so on to your wind to the site where you build the wind turbine, and therefore of course you need a road access. Okay, this is, let's say, a very important aspect when you choose the location. Yeah, now you know, I think, roughly at least, or have an idea how a wind turbine works, what is the technology about the wind turbine, and what you should keep in mind when you select your location. In the next part, I want to tell you and want to calculate together with you the economics. Yeah, how can you see, is it a good project which you may be interested to invest into, or if it's not profitable? Yeah, and this is what we want to do next. first of all, the income is always the difference between your revenues and your costs. Yeah. And what you see on the slide here are the main revenues on the left side and the main costs on the right side. The revenues is actually what you get from the financial point of view out of your wind turbine. And the cost is, I think you know what you have to pay in order to build and to operate your wind turbine. The revenues is therefore what you really like. Yeah, and the cost is, I think, is what you do not like so much, but you cannot have one thing without the other. Let's start with the revenues, so the nice part of it. But first of all, let's see about the time phases for the revenues and the costs. Yeah, you can differentiate between revenues and costs before operation, during operation, and even after operation. So the revenues you may get before operation are subsidies, yeah, from the government or from any other organization. Maybe there are some fundings for your wind turbine. During operation, you may get even more subsidies, which you I think like very much, but the main, and really, I want to emphasize this, the main aspect of your income and revenues during operation, and this is what you get from your electricity sale. Yeah, you generate electricity. Yeah, this is what we have seen before, the PW. Yeah, the equation you may remember from one of the first slides. You get electricity out of your wind turbine. You multiply this electricity with the price of electricity, and this is what you get from the operation of your turbine. And this is by far the most important revenue. And this is why I told you so much about wind speed and power of the wind and so on, because this is the main aspect you need to think about when you think of wind turbines and the beneficial aspect of it. And now let's have a look on the cost aspect. Yeah, the part that you, I think, don't like so much, me as well. But as I said, you cannot have the revenues without the costs. And first of all, you need to pay already before you even start operation. Yeah, this is the investment. And this is not only the price of the wind turbine, which I think is clear to all of you, and the groundworks, I think, as well. But you will most likely need to build an access road, yeah, for transport of all your wind turbine equipment and your workforce and so on. You will have to build a certain connection to the grid. And what is also very important is you will have to do a wind survey. Yeah, you need to know before you build your wind turbine and your wind park if there's really wind blowing or not. Yeah, and this is why you need to do this wind survey and to do this very properly, to know, okay, is there really any wind which I can harvest, or is there not? And last but not least, the wind are the approvals that you need to build your wind park. So after you've done all this and you do the commissioning, then you start operation. Yeah, and during operation, I think most of you know it. Yeah, you have to do certain maintenance, and you sometimes even have to do some repairs. And yeah, then you also have to pay for technical operation. Yeah, you need some workforce that keep track on your windmill and so on. But you will also have to pay usually for compensation measures. Yeah, and these compensation measures are what I've told you about before. If you have certain species that have been living in that area before and which you had to bring to another place in order to get the approval for your windmill and your wind park, then this is what is meant here with compensation measures. Another point is that you do not only get electricity out of your wind park, but you also have to put electricity in, yeah, unfortunately, but all the controls and so on need power, yeah. It's like with your smartphone, yeah, it also needs power, and so all the control that needs power as well. Then if you do not own the site where the power plant is built, then you also need to pay rent for the site, and maybe you have to pay for some insurance as well. So, and when you had a look at the revenue side, yeah, you saw revenues before and during operation, but no revenues after. Unfortunately, this is not the same for the cost aspect. Yeah, costs you also will have after operation, and therefore you need to earn as much money that you can pay for this cost after operation. And this is actually the disposal of your turbine. So you somehow need to get rid of it. Yeah, and you have to restore the land. But yeah, this cost impact is usually not as high as the other ones I've shown you before. So, and I think this was all very dry. So let's jump into an example. Yeah, and what I showed you here is a nice small wind park. Yeah, we have four wind turbines standing on the open field. So good wind conditions, and you think everything is perfect. So this should be a very good investment. And let's assume this investment, you have to pay $20 million for it. And you already estimate decommissioning will be something around 1 million. And what you see on the right side, yeah, in this little diagram here is this 20 million year investment. This is the red column in year zero. So here on the horizontal line, we have all the years. Yeah, and in year one, you start operation and you have some operational costs, and you even get some revenues, and then you operate your wind turbine for 20 years. And in the end, you have to pay this $1 million in year 21 for decommissioning. So this is the example I brought for you to show you how the investment goes. What you can see on this diagram already is that the costs and also the revenues increase over time. Yeah, this is actually because of one aspect, and this is what we want to have a look at a little bit deeper now. And this is called the inflation. Yeah, and inflation, I think everyone knows from you when you go shopping, yeah, and you put all your things in this small basket. And you remember, okay, so in this year, 2021, I have around about $1,000 per year, per month, that I have to pay for all what I need to pay for, yeah, to buy some food in the supermarket, to pay for rent, to pay for my car, and so on. Let's assume you pay $1,000 today. But I guess you know that next year it will not be $1,000 anymore, yeah? Because you have a certain rate of inflation, meaning that you have an increase of costs over time. And therefore, next year you cannot get this basket for $1,000 anymore, but you will have to pay $20 more. Yeah? So meaning $1,020 per month. And the year after, it will be even more expensive. Yeah, so it's then even $1,040. And I think this inflation is, is known to you, to most of you, and that means simply that the prices go up, and therefore the value of your money is going down. And now I'm really sorry, but I need to get back to some equations. I think it's not getting really really complicated. So the rate of inflation from this example can be calculated with this equation. And here, so we take this $1,020, subtract the $1,000 and divide by the $1,000 from year 21. And then we see, okay, we have 2% of inflation. Yeah, and then therefore the value of your money today is $1,000. But when you think of the value of your money in real terms, and I want to emphasize this real terms, next year is only $980. Yeah, and this means actually that you can already think that the money that you have tomorrow is has a lower value than it has today. Yeah, and this is actually meant by this rate of inflation. Yeah, and this calculation here. And going from this example into the general rule, yeah, you have this increase of costs over year divided by the actual costs, and that means actually what you see here, that you have the in real terms the rate of inflation that you have to divide. Or that you have the value of your money today and to divide this by one plus the rate of inflation to get into to get the value of your money tomorrow. Yeah, and if you make it even more, put another variable in and want to know what is not tomorrow but in a arbitrary year T, yeah, we want to call it T. So T can be one if you think about next year, or two if you think about the year 2023. Then you need to put this T into the power here, yeah. So you have one plus inflation rate to the power of T. So this is the best aspect when you think about time. Yeah. So the value of your money in time is getting less and less. This is not so nice. But, and this is now the good part of it, there's also an increase in your money. Yeah. And an increase is always done if you think about bringing your money, let's say, to the bank, yeah, and put it on your bank account, and usually you should get some interest, and therefore you have more and more money tomorrow or the year after. But this interest is not only when you put your money on your bank account, but if you invest money, yeah. So let's think you buy some shares on the stock market. Yeah, and these shares cost you $1,000 today, but maybe next year you sell these shares at the stock market again and get $1,040. So interest is always connected to any investment you do. Yeah, and the interest should be positive, yeah, so that you earn money with your investment. And in this example, which I brought you here, is that next year you have a certain interest of $40. Yeah, and in the year after, you have an interest of $42. So that in total, you have not only $1,040. But then in 23, you have $1,082. And this means that when you think about time and your money, then over the time, you get more and more money. Yeah, so, and this compensates a little bit that the value of your money is going down and down. And again, some more equations. And first, we have a look on this example. So we were thinking about $1,000 on your bank account. You get an interest of $40. So in the end, you can calculate that you have 5% of interest rate, and get to this value. And the general rule is again shown here on the right side. And from this rule, you can calculate similar to what we have done before, that the money on your bank account in an arbitrary year T is shown by this equation. Yeah, with the only difference that before we were dividing by the inflation rate, but here we have to multiply with the interest rate. So I know this is very dry, and I'm getting to the end of this dry section, hopefully. We want to first now combine both effects before I can show you what this has as impact on your investment, yeah, why this is all important. Combining both effects, this is the equation you remember from the inflation, this is the equation you remember from the interest. We combine both, and then we get to this year, yeah, where you have again the interest rate as the multiplier and the inflation rate as the divisor. And when you now think of the example again, and think that you put $1,000 on your bank account, we assume an interest rate of 4% and inflation rate of 2%, and then we want to know, okay, how much is the value of my money in real terms, and I really put the emphasis here on real terms again, so in 4 years future. Then we can calculate this easily with this equation we had here on top. Yeah, and then we find out, okay, we have in real terms a value of $1,122.9. And this means that you can buy the basket that you had before, yeah, and even more. Yeah, so you have $1,000 to pay for this basket, which we had at the beginning. And you have an additional $122 that you can pay for whatever you like. Yeah. So you have this on top. So therefore, it's quite nice. So coming back to our wind turbine and the investment of into the wind park. This is again what you should remember from some slides earlier. Yeah, we have here again the high investment of 20 million, the operating costs and the revenues, and the decommissioning. And what you need to do, you need to somehow compare all your revenues and your costs. Yeah, if you want to know if it's a good and beneficial investment, then you need to know, do I have to pay more or do I get out more of this? So are the revenues higher or are the costs higher? If the costs are higher, then you should keep away from such an investment. Yeah. But if the revenues are higher, then you should think about investing. The problem is only, and this is what I've shown you before, that you just cannot compare each year with the next one. Yeah, we have seen before that the value of your money changes from year to year, so you cannot just add up all the grain, all the green columns, and then add up all the red columns and compare then both sums and say, okay, the green columns in sum are more than the red columns, and therefore it should be good. No, it's unfortunately not so easy. But with the equations and which I've shown you before, we can do a small transformation. And this is shown on this slide. And all these arrows, which I've put on here, that show you that you transform all your revenues and your costs to the year zero, meaning to the year when you do the investment. And this can be done by applying the equation which we were thinking about before, yeah? Which I've shown you just before. Yeah, and with this equation, you can transform all the costs to year zero. So the value of the costs is transformed by this equation to year zero. And the same happens to the revenues. Yeah. And if you have everything then to year zero, then you're talking on the same basis, and then you really can compare easily. And this transformation is called discounting. Yeah. So we discount all revenues and costs by using this equation. And what I've brought you here as an example, yeah, we think about an inflation rate of 2%. We have an interest rate of 7%. And if we have a look at the revenues, yeah, in the first year, we let's assume a revenue of $7 million, then we can calculate by applying this equation that in real terms, we have $6.67 million in year zero. Yeah, and this can be done for all other revenues, and for year 20, we assume that we already have an income of $10.2 million, and this transformed into year zero is only 3.92 million. Yeah, so as you see here, this time effect is really dramatic. Yeah, we with the time effect, we only have, let's say, one third of the original money as a value now still in year zero. And now we can compare. Yeah. We sum up all revenues and we do the same thing with the costs and sum them also up. And then we see, okay, the revenues or the sum of all these revenues are more than 100 million euros and the sum of all costs are less than 100 million euros. And therefore, oh, we find out the revenues are higher than the costs. And yeah, it seems to be a profitable investment. But it's not as easy as that. Yeah. Unfortunately, and I'm sorry to say, but yeah, there's also a bad side of all this, because you cannot be sure if your estimates have always been correct. Yeah. You do not know, or you may be able to know that these $7 million are a correct assumption for next year. Yeah. So this should be okay. But who can look 20 years into the future? Yeah, I told you about climate change at the beginning. Yeah, so maybe there's like no wind blowing in this location in 20 years anymore. So what you want to do and what you need to do really is what is called sensitivity analysis. Yeah, so you keep all variables stable, but you change one variable. And in this example, I changed the revenues. Yeah, I said, okay, in next year, you do not earn $6 million with your wind park, but you do not earn $7 million anymore, but you only earn $6 million with your wind park. Yeah, and then you can do again this transformation. And in 20 years, you do not earn more than $10 million, but only less than $9 million with your wind park. And so you do the same calculation as before. Yeah, everything the same. It's quite easy. And then you turn out that the sum of all revenues discounted to year zero is less than $60 million. But all the costs, let's say, they keep the same, yeah? So you still are almost at 70 million euros in costs. And therefore you see, in this case, it's really bad. You have more costs than revenues, and therefore it's not profitable anymore. Yeah? And this sensitivity analysis shows you how stable your calculation is, yeah? And how big the impact on all your assumptions can be and is allowed to be in order to still be profitable. And therefore, and this is the main thing I want to bring you with this slide, is be careful about your assumptions, yeah, and make sure that your assumptions are good. So now I'm almost getting to the end of my presentation, and therefore I want to sum up what I've told you before. The main messages of this, of the last 60 minutes are that we have many aspects influencing the power output of the wind turbine. And the power output is actually the main influencer when it comes to revenues. Yeah. And since the revenues is what is paying you your wind turbine project, the power output is very, very important when you think about this investment. So choose your location carefully and make sure that you have always strong wind blowing at your wind turbine location. This is message one. And the second message is what you've seen in the second part. You need to do a certain kind of discounting of your revenues and costs. And this is done by the equations I've shown you. And you should make sure that the sensitivity analysis shows you its high stability of your profitability, and then you can invest. And the last message, I think, is for me at least, is the most important one. You may be good engineers, yeah, and engineering was why I chose this subject for my studies. But I quickly understood that engineering is not all. Yeah? It's important that what you do with all your engineering and all these great ideas and the things you learn and do, this is the technological part. Yeah, and this is very great, and these are good things. But you need to take care of the economic aspect. Yeah? You should have a certain economic understanding. And only if you have that, then your project and your investment will be good. Yeah, and then your ideas can become true. And if you do not take care and do not have a good argument on the economical side, then your product will not be bought. And therefore, this is my message to all engineers among you. Also think about the economic aspects. And it's not that you need to go deep into it, but think about it. Yeah, and show to everyone else that your idea is really a profitable one, because only when it pays out, then it will be bought and people will listen to you. And this is actually the end. I hope there was something in for everyone of you. And if you have questions, then you are free to ask. And that's what I want to bring to you.
Okay, thank you very much. That's it, yeah? You have all done your explanation, Andreas?
Yes.
Okay, thank you very much. I really appreciate your kindness to share the knowledge to everybody here. And then as I mentioned earlier in the beginning of the webinar, that there will be a question and answer session. So please, anyone, academic staff or students who has a question, please, you can write it in the chat, or you just open your mic and then say something. For students, please mention your name and your class so that I know it's you who asked the questions. Okay, who want to take the first opportunity?
I'm sorry, ma'am, I want to ask.
Okay, say your name and then your question.
Let me introduce myself. My name is Avicenna. I'm a last year student at Pence. I want to ask something. If we had to choose between investment more on Turbine itself or on the grid connections, and since, as I know, the wind energy in Indonesia can only produce less electricity than any conventional power plant. And I think because of that, it can only provide electricity for a relatively small area. That's what I want to ask.
Sorry, what I did not really understand. So what is the question you really want to know? I'm sorry.
So if you have more than one question, so I think it's better to say the questions one by one. So first question, what is your first question? And then the second one. So I think it makes more understandable, yeah, the question. You get what I mean?
Get it.
Yeah, okay. And then not more than two, yeah, because, well, maybe some people, the next after you will have also some questions. So I think maximum two questions per person, yeah, because we don't have much time to have a question and answer session here. Okay.
If we had to choose, what is more worth of money between investment more on wind turbine or on the grid connection? That's what I want to ask.
Okay. The grid connection, of course, is always what you need anyway. Yeah. Without the grid connection, your wind power plant will not be beneficial, because you need to get somehow the power away from your wind turbine into the national grid. Of course, you can also have some, let's say, local power, but then you need also to have some electricity storage. Yeah, if you want to have some, let's say, some isolated island that you generate your electricity for, and have no connection to the grid, you can do this also, but then you really have to be careful, because instead of the connection to the grid, then you need to get need to have some battery kind of things, some power storage, and this can also be very expensive. So it depends on really the location. I know about projects where people have a certain home, and they have a windmill outside or next to their home, and they generate electricity and also have an electricity storage. But you really need to be careful if this can be beneficial. Usually it's good to have the connection to the national grid, because then you are not so much depending on the wind to generate electricity, because without wind you do not generate electricity, and then you all your electronic devices will not run, and this is the reason why you either have the power storage, or you have the national grid that can then supply power for these times without wind. So this should be checked case by case. There's no general answer for it, but this is something you need to evaluate before you start your investment. Yeah, and this can be part of the investment costs, when you do all these surveys, as I told you about the wind survey and so on, then you should also find out how much you have to pay for your grid connection and if you are far away from any other grid, then maybe it's good to have this isolated island where you have a storage solution instead. Yeah, that's it.
Okay, thank you. It's a very clear answer, I think. Is it clear, Avicenna?
Yes, ma'am. That's answer my question. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you. And then second question, maybe? Anyone who wants to ask questions? Okay, while waiting for everyone asking questions, I have questions, Andreas, if you don't mind to answer my question.
Go ahead. Of course, you're welcome.
Okay. Can you please go back to slide 12?
Yeah,
I'm curious about this one. Yeah, like you show us which is the good position and which is not good position. Okay, like for example here in your first picture, so upper picture on the left. Yeah, you show us here that the good position is like side by side. So the first turbine is standing side by side with the second one. If we have the wind direction like this, we know that the wind direction is not steady yet, so it keep changing at all times. Like for example, today we have this kind of direction, and then tomorrow we have another direction. Like for example, say like this direction is going from the west, yeah, and then tomorrow, for example, we have the directions of the wind coming from the north. So here, if we have the direction coming from the north, so we have the position of the turbine is like standing behind, yeah, behind each other. So not next to each other like this one. Okay, you get what I mean, yeah?
Yeah, it's a very good point. It's a very good point.
I was just curious, Will. I was just curious how we overcome this situation, yeah, because we know that the wind direction is not always the same all times.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, actually, one solution is you install moving wind turbines, yeah, that move from one place to the other. But okay, this is not existing actually. Yeah. So, of course, you're completely right. When the wind is or the direction of the wind is changing, then you will also have sometimes good directions and sometimes directions which are not as good. But this is why you need to do the wind survey before. Yeah? You and from this wind survey, you find out the main directions and the usual directions of your wind. Yeah? Because usually it's you have wind coming, let's say, from the west, yeah, and not as often from the north or the other way around, yeah. But you know this from your wind survey, and when you find out, okay, the usual direction is from west to east, then you build the turbines standing one in the north and one in the south. So as you see on the right side. Then of course it may happen that you have wind coming from the north, but as this is not as often the case, it's still the better position than having them standing one in the west and one in the east. And you cannot prevent it by 100%, but you can reduce the problem with the changing directions of the wind. Okay, we have someone holding up the hand.
I get it. I think we have lots of questions here in the chat. Can you read the chat that there are some students asking about
can you read it?
Okay, so this question is coming from Nanda, I read his question. Yeah, I have questions for you, Mr. Lucian. Based on what you tell about investment in wind turbine, it looks like this is for some who have a wind park, but could it be used for individual, like the solar energy?
With good what?
So basically, Nanda asked questions whether the calculations and all the explanations for the investment can be applied in other renewable energy, like for example, in solar energy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this is a very good point. Yeah, so all these equations, yeah, it's they can be applied for any investment. Yeah, I think if this is the question, this is something I did not mention, and therefore it's good that you're asking. Of course, you can use this for any other investment. Yeah, and I really mean any. If you build a solar power plant, yeah, you also have certain revenues and certain costs, and you can apply this in the same way. This is the reason why I use this very general equations, yeah, and this, let's say, basics, because this can be used for all. You can even do this when you start another business, yeah, and when you want to start building, let's say, electric fueled cars, yeah? You can also use these equations and this idea behind it. So yeah, this is true for all investments. I hope this answers the question.
Yeah, I think it's very clear, and it also answers the questions. Next questions. This question is coming from Fadil. Okay, and then he asks whether how much money that we have to spend if we want to invest in one wind turbine.
Oh, that depends really on the size of your turbine. You can buy wind turbines for some $100,000 of dollars, but there's other turbines, especially when you think about offshore winds, then a turbine costs even more than $1 million. So it really depends on the size and your location and so on. This is that's so a big range.
Do you think offshore wind turbine is more expensive?
Usually, because the offshore wind turbine, the problem about offshore wind turbine is the foundation is difficult to build. Yeah, you have to build a certain foundation somewhere in the sea. Usually, you're not directly on the shoreline, but somewhere out in the sea. So you have to go down through the, let's say, through the water to get to the ground and build the foundation there and to have to take benefit of all your of all these hard works to build the foundation. You usually build a big wind turbine, and this big wind turbine is then very expensive as well. And after investing into this turbine, you need to pay a certain amount of money for maintenance and repairs. And this is also not as easy compared to onshore wind turbines, yeah? Because you have to have special trained people, you have to have boats going out, and the atmosphere out in the sea is very aggressive for the wind turbine. Yeah, so you need to apply special materials and so on. Yeah, this is why it's actually a wind turbine, an offshore wind turbine is usually more expensive for investment and maintenance, but on the same side, as I showed you before, yeah, due to the stable wind conditions, it is also you have more power output of the from the offshore wind turbine usually.
This is
why it can be a good investment.
I think the power output is very demanding. Yeah, in offshore wind turbine, we can get much more power than if we build a wind turbine in the onshore, I think, because that's why I knew that some company now they build the wind turbine on the offshore more than the onshore because they can get lots of power. Nowadays, I think. And then also maybe the civil engineering technology is also quite improving because they can build what the foundation as you just mentioned. Yeah, the foundation is very expensive if we build in offshore, but maybe they can now the civil engineering technology they can get less expensive or even cheaper. So that's why they go to the offshore right now.
Yeah. So it is, of course, the high investment may be an obstacle at the beginning, but in the long run, there's also offshore wind parks can be beneficial. Yeah, there's a reason why, for instance, in the shoreline before Britain, or also before in front of Germany, so in the North Sea, there are many wind parks. Yeah.
And I think also in Denmark, because when I went there, I traveled, I think near the airport in Copenhagen, they have a wind farm along the oceans, just near the airport, I think. I can't remember what is the name, but I saw at that time from above, lots of wind turbines built in the ocean, in the channel, in the channel in the Denmark. Okay. We have lots of questions here, Andreas. So please be patient. I think students are more curious nowadays in engineering, economic engineering. So that's why they raise a lot of questions. Okay, next question. This question's coming from Dea. She asked about the most plants still use coal. Okay, in Indonesia today, most plants still use coal as their fuel. And the coal business is one of the largest tax contributors in Indonesia. If Indonesia wants to try to change to renewable energy, what are the challenges that might be faced?
Yeah, so actually it's similar to to the situation here in Germany. We were for a long time relying on coal, and we still do, so coal is still one of the major contributors when it comes to electricity generation. I think the obstacles are, what is really a problem is that the forecast of the wind power is really difficult to make, you do not always know if the wind is blowing tomorrow. You can estimate, of course, wind forecasts are quite good, but they cannot tell you for sure. And one problem is that, as you know, sometimes the wind is blowing and sometimes not. And the advantage of the coal power plant is that you can rely on it. Yeah, you switch it on. You switch it off, and you know that when it's switched on, you get power. Yeah, for the wind turbine, it's not the same, and this is why also in Germany, wind power is getting a little bit into problems and into trouble, and I think this will be the same in Indonesia. And when you do the change, it's also the problem that from the coal power plant, you have definitely a power plant which may look not so nice. Yeah, okay, this depends on the point of view, but many people don't really like to have their home right next to a coal power plant. But the same is true for the wind power plant. Yeah, the wind power plant is maybe not what someone has when he is sitting on his terrace or looking outside of his window. And this is a problem, I think, in Indonesia as well as in Germany. And the reason why I say this is that you need much more wind power plants compared to a coal power plant. Yeah, from a coal power plant, you can get, let's say, 1 gigawatt out of power for a really big power plant. Yeah, but to generate 1 gigawatt out of power, you need really a huge area with filled with wind power plants and wind turbines. And the problem is to really find enough open area to build all these wind turbines. Actually, this is really what is what we are facing in Germany at the moment. Yeah, in let's say the early 2000s, there was a huge increase in wind turbine construction. But in the last years, the protests, and this is what I told you before, the protests against the construction of new wind turbines were so high that we have only a few turbines being built anymore year by year. And in the past, it was really many turbines being built. And therefore, yeah, this can also be your problem. Yeah. I think, does this somehow answer the question?
I think it answered the questions. Okay.
But sorry to interrupt, because it just comes to my mind. Yeah. What really helps, and this is the way to fight against this problem and to prevent this problem, is to help the people investing in their own local power plant. Yeah, so in here we have some initiatives that the locals put together their money and build their own wind park. Yeah, so it's not not just any investor coming from the outside investing and putting there this windmill, but it's the locals themselves who build these wind turbines and who also earn money with it. Yeah, so this is a way how you can help or you can reduce this protest against the new construction of wind parks. Yeah, to also take the locals and show them that they themselves can earn money with it. Yeah, and that this is a way to increase the acceptance of such a wind turbine project. Sorry. Yeah, this is what I wanted to put into it as well.
Thank you. I think it's very, very good answers. Hope it answers the asked questions. And then now I think we have another questions from Kartika. She said, thank you very much for your knowledge sharing with us. And then she wants to ask that previously mentioned that wind turbine gets old will be decommissioned. So what happened to the turbines that are already used? Is it recycled or just thrown away?
Oh, this depends. So some parts can be reused again. Some other parts, let's take for example the tower. Yeah, often this needs to be thrown away, or depending also the way how it's constructed. But of course, you should reuse as many parts as possible. Yeah. When you think about the rotor or the nacelle or the metal parts in it, that is usually reused again in other applications. The motor or the generator, for that, it's true as for any other generator in other power plants. Yeah. Everything that can be reused should be reused. And it has been different in the past, but these days more parts of such a turbine are reused again. Yeah, but yeah, that's actually sometimes you can do something called repowering. This is actually you usually take away the old turbine and build a new turbine at the same site, but the new turbine is usually has a higher power output. Yeah, it's the new turbine is more efficient. Usually it's larger than the old turbine. So this is when it comes to reuse the site. Yeah, you can do this by what is called repowering, meaning building, taking away the old windmill and building a new one. But coming back to the original question, of course you have to recycle then the old turbine that still needs to be done. Yeah. And yeah, some parts can be reused, others cannot.
Can you reuse it for another renewable energy devices?
Let's say this does not have to be, it can be used for any application that is reasonable, let's say, yeah. So it does not have to mean that it's okay. It's a renewable energy device, but any application, this is most, this is best suited for it should be
standard. Now, if we look for from the investment point of view, if we used component like what you just said, does it mean that investment is becoming less expensive or cheaper, or it's just the same?
No. Of course, if you can reuse the old turbine, then you may be able to earn some money with it. But the disposal of other parts that you cannot reuse will be sometimes also very expensive. Yeah, so you should not rely on the reuse of certain parts of your turbine. Yeah, your investment should be stable also without this. This reuse, of course, for certain parts of your wind turbine, you get money after decommissioning, but not for all. And this is also true when you think of other machines. Yeah, some parts you can make money with it. After disposal and after decommissioning, but for others you just cannot. So you have to look at this piece by piece.
Okay. Next question. The question is coming from Delva. Basically, Delva asks about which is more economical. I mean, it's more profitable if we want to build small wind turbines. So many small wind turbines, or it's just few wind turbines but bigger size.
So the direction goes into larger turbines in the last years. But I cannot give you a general rule for this. Yeah, you cannot say, okay, this is always the right way to go. Very often you see bigger wind turbines being built, and when I told you about this repowering, yeah, very often it is that you replace a small turbine by a larger, more efficient one. But I don't want to say this is always the right way to go. Yeah. Now there may be conditions why the smaller one is better, but usually you go to larger sizes.
I think it also depends on the renewable energy resources in the area. Yeah, because maybe there are there are times in that area that the turbine is blowing so big, so that maybe for larger wind turbine is more profitable. And maybe so I think it also depends on the resources, yeah?
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
Okay. Still we have some question here. Be patient, Andreas. We still have lots of questions. I told you that maybe this lecture will be running for 3 hours. Well, we lucky us that you have holiday right now, yeah. So that's why.
Yeah.
No rush to finish the lecture.
But tomorrow I need to work.
I know.
That's everything all right. It's all right. I'm happy that you're interested in this topic, yeah, and that you're curious about renewable energies.
I think maybe nowadays engineers should also consider about the economical point of view, yeah, in any of their work. So because this is also important. Okay, next question is coming from Dendi. So he asked, if we use the wind turbine, then we have to use a large area. In this case, the wind turbine and turbines can be applied to a smaller scale, such as in the street lighting. What do you ask, Dendi? I'm confused. Maybe I think Dendi asked something about the applications, whether it is applicable to use a wind turbine in a small area, like for the street lighting, something like that. Is that applicable if we use wind turbine in a small area and then use for a certain purposes, like for street lighting?
In general, I wouldn't exclude this idea. Yeah, if you have, let's say, a kind of remote area where you do not have the connection to the national grid, this could be an idea. But this is what I said earlier. Then you need to think about certain electrical storage devices. Because with wind power, you have the problem that the wind is not always blowing, so you do not generate always electricity. And therefore, for a remote area and with the application of a certain storage solution, this can also be beneficial, and also be used. Otherwise, if you have the connection to the national grid, of course you can also connect a small turbine to the grid and use the have the electricity for your traffic light from the turbine when the wind is blowing and from the national grid when the wind is not blowing. You always need to make sure that you always have enough energy coming into your consumer. Yeah. This is very important. I hope this somehow answers the question.
Yeah, I think it answered the questions. Now we come to the next questions. This question is coming from Rudy. So basically, Rudy asks if we have a rural area, and then we know that rural area is more windier. So we have windy area in a rural place. And then in that place, also we have lots of sunshines during the day. So Rudy asks, which one is preference to build in that area, whether it's wind turbine or solar energy?
My answer would be build both, use the sunshine, use the wind, make a lot of money with it and be happy. But it's really like that. You should make a survey for the sunshine and you should compare it to a survey for the wind. And then you should compare both and see what is more beneficial. It really depends on how much sunshine is there, how much wind is there, and in the end, you cannot give a general answer. Yeah, it's always depending on the local conditions, but at least this is the case here, since people do really not want to have these wind turbines standing in their free view. Yeah, when they look outside their window, they don't want to see these turbines. Maybe also because of their noises. Yeah, when you have the rotors in the wind, you have some noise emissions and so on. Therefore, for the acceptance, the solar is probably easier because you can build them on the top of your house, yeah, on your roof. You do not really see the solar panels as long as they are not standing in the open field. But when you build them on your house, you have no noise emissions from the solar panels. This is the reason why there's still an increase in installation of solar power in Germany, whereas the wind installation has been going down. But yeah, again, this depends on you, on the acceptance of the wind power. It's hard to say in general. There are certain factors, yeah, and the most important, I would say, is really the acceptability of one technology or the other, and the survey. Yeah, do a survey and see how much wind, how much sunshine there is really, how much you can harvest, and then take your answer from that.
Okay, this is the last questions from the chat, yeah, from the chat. Mm-hmm. So the last question is coming from Fahmi. So he asks, is there any sort of limitation regarding on the wind turbine blades density? So he asks about blades density, because the blades weight can affect the generated energy from the wind, and the blades shouldn't be too light or too heavy.
I'm not sure if I really understood it right. I say something and then you tell me if it's correct concerning your question. So in general, the power output does not depend on the weight of your blade, yeah. But of course, and this is actually a very good question. Therefore, the weight of the blade does influence the size of the blade. Yeah, I told you about centrifugal forces when I told you about a blade that breaks and flies away and maybe crashes into a house. Yeah, and this is why we have this certain distance rules for residential areas towards the wind turbine. Due to this very high centrifugal forces, you have to make sure that the blade itself is not too heavy, yeah? And at the same point, it's still strong enough, yeah? So this is a very important thing when it comes to research into wind turbines. Yeah? The manufacturers try to find materials that are lightweight and very strong and stable at the same time, in order to make sure that the yeah, the centrifugal force is not too high to make the blade breaking and finally flying away. And yeah, therefore it's yeah, it's a tough thing for engineers and for all specialists working on these materials for the blades and the design for the blades.
I think it's the work of metallurgy engineers, yeah, because they need to find to improve the materials, the metallurgy, also the processing, so that they have light enough but also rigid enough, yeah, to work as a wind turbine blades.
Yeah, so the it's really dramatic how big the forces at the end, so at the tip of the blade, can be when it's turning on full speed. This is also another reason for this power limitation of each turbine.
Yes, true. Okay, that is the last question on the chat, but I wish another opportunity, one opportunity, maybe last opportunity, because we know that Andreas will have to work and then we don't want to spend his energy much in this seminar, and then he doesn't have any energy tomorrow. We don't want like that.
Okay. Don't worry, we'll be okay.
Yeah, last questions. Maybe anyone, students or maybe iPhone.
Excuse me, ma'am.
Okay. Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. Thank you for the opportunity. My name is Aromega Pertiwi. I want to ask. As you mentioned on the slide that the revenues before operation is just come from the subsidies. My question is, did you mean the subsidy is just comes from the government? And is there any alternative to building a wind industry without government subsidies? Thank you.
Good question. Yeah, actually, so high share usually comes from the government, or there's this is actually the most likely, but of course you can also find other organizations to support this project, yeah, and this can be ecological organizations supporting this idea, or any other supranational organizations that support such projects, like World Bank and so on. For certain countries, three world countries, this can also be some economic support fundings and so on. So there are different possibilities depending on, yeah, the location and the general conditions where this wind turbine project is built. So it does not only have to be the national government, yeah, the different fundings. And sometimes it's even that you get cheap credits from banks, so from national or supranational banks, so that support your idea and where you can get money without paying any interest rate or interest for getting this money. This is also true sometimes.
Does it answer your question?
It's very clear. Thank you, Mr.
You're welcome.
You're welcome. Okay, last chance, last opportunity. If still anyone who have some questions, so I give last time.
Can I say hello to Andreas Guarini?
Oh, yeah. Westy. How are you, Westy?
Yeah. Thank you. Hi, Andreas.
Hi. Good to hear you.
How are you?
Yeah, doing all right. Yeah, it's holiday today, so it's not so bad.
Winston, yeah?
Yeah, richtig. Right.
Okay. I was listening to your lecture. It was interesting, but well, to be honest, I don't really understand about the topic. So yeah, I just want to say hello, so you can continue. Go on.
Okay.
I told you, Bersi, that this is very general. I mean, the topic can be applied in any cases. Yeah, is it right, Andreas? I think
yeah.
It can be also applied in your case. Maybe you want to build, say what you want to build, a company for a broadcasting, something like that, or like a TV station. I think it's also possible. Yeah.
Okay,
really. I see. So if you need to know some more, as Irene just said, if you want to build a broadcasting station also, let me know. You take these two equations, or actually in the end it was just one equation you have to apply, and then you can quickly calculate if it's good or not.
Yeah, okay, I got the point. Maybe because I don't follow in your lecture since the beginning, I joined in the middle, so maybe I missed some part, yeah?
Yeah.
But you can invite Andreas to speak with your students. I think he really loves. He really loves to share his knowledge to anyone, I think.
Okay. We'll consider that.
But then the information about the broadcasting station has to come from you. Yeah, I can tell you about investments and
you
do the rest.
Yeah. Okay then. Continue, please. Silakan Bu Arini lanjut.
Yeah, thank you, Westy. Thank you. Any question again? I think here we have Pak Yoko, Eric. I think also Eric is coming. Oh, Fifi is also. Maybe for Pak Yoko or Fifi or anyone?
Okay, thank you. Hello, Andreas. Hope you are
fine. Hi, Eric.
Andres, thank you for your nice information. That's great. I think renewable energy in Europe, especially German. Andres, I want to ask about nuclear energy that's still used in German or already obsolete. Thank you, Andres. Hope you always find there. Yeah?
Nuclear energy, yeah. It's a hot topic, but to be honest, at the moment we have two or three nuclear power plants still being running, but by the, I think, at least the end of next year, all nuclear power plants will be shut down in Germany. So we will have no nuclear power anymore. I know there are other countries, other European countries who are that are thinking about this nuclear power differently. Yeah, I just heard that in the USA they are building more and more power plants because for them they say it's a kind of green energy. Yeah, because you do not emit CO2. Okay, everyone can think about this in his or her own way. So at least in Germany, to answer your question, at the moment we still have two or three nuclear power plants still running, but by the end of next year, all of them will be turned down.
Okay, thank you very much, Andrea. So I think after next year, no more nuclear energy in Germany, that's right?
Yes, that's right.
Okay. Thank you for
at
your
least not, at least not produced in Germany. Yeah? Maybe we import them from other countries. But
any reason why the government decided to close down the nuclear energy power plant?
Because we said, especially after Fukushima, that it's too dangerous.
But and, I think Fukushima at that time because of the earthquake. Right, it's not like because of the human error, but because of the natural disaster. So that's why then it blows up. Is it right?
Yeah, actually, it's the earthquake, it's the human error, and also honestly, we do not even have any site where we want to dispose the nuclear waste. And as far as I know, there's only one country in the world, or at least in Europe, there's definitely just one country who has a final disposal place for nuclear waste, and this is Finland. And all other countries are still searching for a good place where they can finally dispose their nuclear waste for the next 1,000 or even more years.
I see, I see.
And this is the typical NIMBY, yeah, not in my backyard. So everyone wants to have the electricity, but no one wants to have the waste.
I think all countries want to export the waste to other countries who wants to dispose it.
To be honest, in the 60s, it was much easier because then you can, it was possible that you just take a boat, put all the waste on it, drive into the open sea, like somewhere out in the Atlantic Ocean, throw it out of your boat, and then go back again. But fortunately, this is not the case anymore.
Okay. Thank you very much. I think we spent more than 2 hours here to have what the Andreas just explain, and then also he shared the knowledge for us. And I'm sure for me myself, personally, I found like this lecture is very, very good, and then very beneficial, and then very useful for improving our knowledge. And also I'm sure that I can use this for my future work. Anyone please turn your audio on, because we would have to give a very big applause to our honorable guest lecturer right now. So bring your audio on. Okay, let's give a very big applause to our speaker. This is very, very interesting knowledge. And then we also, as myself and also as the power plant engineering, we would like to say very much thank you to you, and we really appreciate what you have done today. And then if I'm sure that maybe some students still have some questions, some curiosity in their mind, you can raise questions. Just write down the questions to me, and I will forward to Andreas. Would you mind to answer the students' question after this presentation?
No, you're welcome.
Yeah, so see, if some of you still have some questions, so please don't hesitate, just write down, and then you can send it to me, and then I will forward it to Andreas. Okay, again, thank you. Hopefully this is not the last that we can work together. Hopefully in the future we still have more projects, more times to work together. Thank you again, and then enjoy your holiday. Thank you. Yeah, and we see you again next time.
Okay, thank you. Have a good day too. And thank you all for coming and asking your questions.
Okay, see you.
Okay.